Okay, it started.
Okay. Well, praise the Lord.
Learning.
We are learning. I am going to minister today on the bronze basin, our image. Amen. I thought it was interesting. I was listening to Joseph Prince, and he was talking about the bronze. No, it wasn't Joseph Prince. This one was, it was another minister. Okay. And he was talking about the bronze basin and how God used that bronze basin as an image. Now, the bronze basin is part of the tabernacle. It's where the priests go to wash their hands. And when you're washing your hands, you normally look down and you see the water and everything that's with it, and you're looking at it. What I found interesting that in Exodus 38:8, you want to read that?
Yes.
Okay.
He made the laver of bronze and its base of bronze from the bronze mirrors of the serving women who assembled at the door of the tabernacle of meeting.
That's so cool. So when God gave the Israelites favor with the Egyptians when they came out, when Moses came out and Pharaoh let the people go. And they gave them all their gold, a lot of gold, silver, jewelry, everything that they could carry. And along with that, they also gave them their mirrors. And the mirrors were made out of bronze, which is really cool. And bronze, a long time ago, that's how they made the mirrors. And when you looked into it, you could see the reflection of yourself because they really made it smooth and that. So God told Moses to make the brazen basin out of those mirrors. Mm-hmm. So when the priests looked into this basin, they saw themselves and they were washing themselves. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
I thought that was just so incredibly cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so it's basically when you're melting down anything, God is telling us that when you melt down these bronze mirrors, you're melting down your own image. And you're now looking into the image of God.
Well, bronze is a type of humanity.
Praise God. That's cool. Yeah. So we can see our humanity, but then we melt down that humanity. And we look past ourselves. And God's saying, I'm going to give you a new way to see yourself. I'm going to let you see yourself the way I see you so that you don't see yourself as what man has claimed you to be. So you're no longer basing your image on all the people who have put you down, that have attacked you, who have called you names, who have done all these things to you. You're no longer going to see yourself like that. I am melting down these mirrors. In Genesis 1:26, it says, then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. We are made in the image of God. We started out as the image of God. In his image, it says, let us make man in our image. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. So we are made in his likeness. We look like him. We act like him. We are what he looks like here on earth. But then after we got born, things happen. Of course, after Adam and Eve fell, sin entered the world. And then the devil has been constantly attacking our image and constantly attacking the word of God, because there's nothing more that the devil would love to have is a bunch of defeated Christians walking around. If he can't keep you from being a Christian, he wants to get you a defeated Christian.
Mm-hmm.
So that when you go out, you're like in the armor of God, and the devil comes a knocking on you and goes, hey, come a little mouse in here. Instead of fighting as the warriors that we were created to be. Hallelujah. We are made in his image. We're made to look like who he is, to have the authority, to have the power, to have the dominion that he has. Not just walk around as simple humans. Because we are like him on this earth. As he is, so are we in this earth.
Yeah, in 2 Corinthians 3:18, it says, but we all with unveiled face.
Yes. What was that again?
2 Corinthians 3:18.
We are being changed into his glory. Hallelujah. Praise God. You can't reach your destiny until you give God your image. You can't be who you are meant to be, who God has called you to be, until you give God who you are. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but God delivers them out of them all. God never said we would not experience trials and tribulations, but he did say he would pray for us that we would overcome. I find that so incredibly awesome that God would pray for us in the midst of our tribulations, in the midst of our problems. He would pray for us that we will overcome in this world. That is the love of a father. That is the grace of a father. We get beat down so often in this world by other people, by the things that happen to us, by just circumstances around us, the jobs we do, just everything that we run into. We get beat down by those things, and eventually we begin to call ourselves as those things instead of calling ourselves as who we really are, the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. In Luke 22:31-32, you want to read that?
Yeah.
Okay.
And the Lord said, Simon, Simon, indeed Satan has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat, but I have prayed for you that your faith should not fail, and when you have returned to me, strengthen your brethren.
Jesus prayed for Simon. He knew Peter was going to fail. He knew it. He said, Satan came to sift you. And Satan is. He's coming to sift each and every one of us. He wants us to fall because he does not want a bunch of Christians walking around with the image of God, with that power, with that authority. He does not want us walking around commanding him off of our property, off of our possessions, away from our families. He doesn't want that to happen. So he comes to sift us. It says he comes as a roaring lion to deceive even the elect. See, he wants to take us out. But Jesus Christ prayed for us. And he prayed for Peter. He says, but I have prayed for you that your faith should not fail. And this is what, see, Jesus has such faith. He says, and when you return... He didn't say, if you returned. He never said, if. He said, and when you return, go strengthen your brothers. Because it says in Corinthians that where we have been ministered to by the Lord, let us minister that ministry to another. When we've been comforted, comfort another with the same comfort that we've been comforted with. Because when the Lord gives us that anointing to get over things, we're able to reach out to our brothers and sisters in Christ and into the world and to help them to overcome the things that have happened to them. Praise God. That I find amazing.
Water is the type of the word.
Yes.
When you look into the water of the word and wash yourself in it,
oh, praise
you
God.
You see Christ in yourself. You see God's anointing, you see a reflection of him in your own life.
That is good. That is very good. That is so true. We get washed by the water of the word, transforming that image that we see into the image of Christ. Hallelujah. In John 17:15. You want to read that one, hon?
John.
17:15. No, first page. This is the prayer. John is the prayer that Jesus prayed over us.
I pray that you would take them out of the world, but that you would keep them from the evil one.
Amen. So see, the Lord didn't pray that we would not be attacked. Because he knew the attack was coming.
Yeah.
He knew it was coming. That's right. And he knew that we would let him in. He knew it would happen. So instead he said that you should keep them from the evil one. So he prayed that the Father would just encase us in his love, in his grace, in his mercy, and keep us from falling. Keep us in a place that we would read his word, that we would be transformed by the water of the word, that we could look into that brazen altar and no longer see our own self-image, but see the image of God who is within us, and that he would overtake us and we would be who we were created to be. Hallelujah. God's word, his word, the water of the word will melt down your old image. That's amazing. It will literally melt that old image and create you into who you were meant to be. The righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. To be filled with his grace. To be as he is in this world. To be a king and priest unto your God. You know, kings and priests are pretty cool. You know, they have power and authority. And they walk around knowing they have that power and authority. See, we are a king and priest unto our God. We have right standing with our God. We are holy and sanctified and redeemed before our God. Oh, we are privileged. So true. So privileged. Amen. I'm going to go over a couple people who we can see was changed by God. Amen. First, we're going to talk about Jacob. The main story of Jacob is told through Genesis 25 through 34. We're just going to read little pieces of it here and there. So Jacob and his brother Esau were twins. And of course, Jacob grabbed the heel of his brother as he was coming out. And so through life, he must have always felt like the second one, always felt like I'm not good enough. Because my brother is getting the blessing. My brother is getting all the anointing from my dad. You know, and of course, he's going around and his image, I imagine his image was pretty low. Just because of who he was and the strength of his brother. Because I see his brother, I mean, he was a pretty strong dude. I mean, he was a hunter. He could haul a deer back and have Jacob cook it, and then sell his birthright. Because he didn't care about nothing. He knew he had it all. He wasn't concerned. So I see him as a guy who just knew he had everything. And Jacob as this, probably his brother, who was probably bullied by him. Yeah. Amen. So in Genesis 32, 1 through 2. I thought this was interesting. You know, names and anything in the Word of God always have meaning. So look them up. And I saw this because it's funny. I have read this story so many times, but I did not know that he saw angels twice. Well, actually three times, because there was a stairway to heaven. He also saw a stairway to heaven when he fell asleep. It was a dream he had. And he saw angels descending and ascending on the stairway. But here in Jacob 32, 1 and 2, it said, and the angels of God met him. I wonder what happened on that encounter. But I found the name interesting. Mahanan means two camps. So I can see that Jacob must have been divided, because this is when he was going to go and find a bride. This is after he had already deceived his brother. See, I'm sure that God had another plan in mind when he said that he was going to be the blessed one. But of course, man, we normally take our things into our own hands and we decide to accomplish them on our own way. And when we do that, we end up doing it, you know, we shorten things out. You know, like Sarah and Abraham, she decided to have one baby first instead of waiting. And the same thing with Jacob. He decided, okay, his mom said, let's do it this way before your dad dies. You know, so they did that, and he supplanted his brother. And Jacob literally means supplanter. Yeah. So he meets these angels of God. I'm wondering if that was the Lord who met him. And he tells him, you have two camps. You're seeing yourself as who you think you are, but that's not who you are. You're not a supplanter. You're not less than what I made you to be. This camp over here, who I am, says that you are a conqueror. You are a warrior. You are a man of God. You're going to do things for me, great things for me. So it's almost like the Lord was preparing him to rename him as well. I find that amazing. I had never seen, I mean, it's like you see things, but then you don't see them when you're reading. So he actually, he met these angels of men. And these angels of God, and these angels let him know that he was flowing in two camps. He's going to have to choose which camp he's going to be in. And of course, then he went on down all the way down to his cousin's house at that Laban's his cousin or way back there. Yeah, some cousin. And he wanted to marry Rachel. But of course, he got tricked and got Leah instead. And then he worked another 7 years and he got Rachel. And then he decided he thought his father-in-law was never going to let him go. So he took off back. And he was being the wrong camp again. He was afraid. He wasn't waiting on God. He took off because of fear. The same thing that happened when he took off from Jacob. He took off because of fear. And God already met him on the way. And he said, look, you got two camps here. You're going to have to choose. And so he's heading back. And while he's heading back, something interesting happens in Genesis 32. We're going to read verse 27, I think. Yeah, verses 27 through 28 we're going to read. So he said to him, what is your name? He said, and this is, okay, so give a little background. An angel came and met him again. But this time he wrestled with the angel. Now you have to think that Jacob had to be pretty strong after tending the sheep and taking care of all the things he did and everything that he did. He had to be pretty strong. And so he wrestles this angel. And, of course, the angel hits him right on the side of the thigh. So he limps the rest of his life. But he literally holds on to this angel. And he says, I will not let go until you bless me. And he just continues just to wrestle with him and not let go of him. And so, finally, when the wrestling ends, the angel says to him, he says, what's your name? Like the angel didn't know what his name was. But he wanted Jacob to acknowledge what his name was. And Jacob said, Jacob. See, he was still in the other camp. And he said, your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel. For you have struggled with God and with men and have prevailed. Praise God. He was showing him that he was a warrior. That he was a conqueror. He prevails against an angel of God. He prevailed. And of course, we know what happened with Israel. Israel means God prevails. So God gave him a new name, a new identity. Through all the trials and the tribulations he went through, it developed a character in him. That he was going to prevail no matter what. If he had been given Rachel first, that wouldn't have made him as strong as he was. So he got Leah first. Amen? So when he had to fight another 7 years. And then after that, he had to go on more years to work for his father-in-law. But of course, he didn't know who he was yet. But at this point, he found out who he was. He was a prevailer. He was a man of God, and he chose the other path. He decided to choose to follow God as the warrior and the conqueror that he was. He went on, met his brother, brother forgave him, and went on to become a great man and to start the nation of Israel with his 12 sons, or the 12 tribes of Israel. That's incredible. Jacob was afraid of his older brother, and he ran. Jacob's name was changed when he fought the angel. He became Israel instead. His image was changed. He now saw himself as a man who could accomplish great things. Hallelujah. He stepped into his greatness. And each one of us can do the same thing as our image is changed by the washing of the word. When we see ourselves in the mirror of God. In 1 Corinthians 13, the very last verses of it. We can go to it. It says, for now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know even as also I am known. How are we going to know? Amen. We're going to know as we are known, as we are seen in the eyes of God. We are going to know who we are. Praise God. In 15 and 16 of Isaiah, this is still talking about the God is speaking to his servant Jacob now. And he says, behold, I will make you into a new threshing sledge with sharp teeth. You shall thresh the mountains and beat them small and make the hills like chaff. You shall winnow them. The wind shall carry them away and the whirlwind shall scatter them. You shall rejoice in the Lord and the glory and the Holy One and glory in the Holy One of Israel. God was calling him to be who he was in him. And he told him who he was going to be. And that's who he became when he wrestled that angel. He made the choice to follow the other path. When you look at the last part of where's Isaiah 41, 8 through 20, in verse 20, it says that the hand of the Lord, he's going to make sure that he knows that the hand of the Lord had done this and that the Holy One of Israel has created it, had created what was done within him. That word done right there, it's three parts of the Hebrew. It has three Hebrew letters. And the first one is, I think it's pronounced A-N. It means to see, to understand, or to look. And the second letter is sin. It means to feed. Can also mean the point of a rock and to chew, devour, or consume something. And the last word is hey. The last letter is hey, which means grace. That's literally saying that the hand of the Lord has done this, that the hand of the Lord will feed you grace. And then you will see that God has created this. That's amazing. See, when we realize that we are living in a time of grace, that it's God's grace that has created us. It's his grace that has done this thing in us, not ourselves. Amen? It's not us who did it. It is God who transforms us from the inside out so that we are seen as we are known. Amen. When you see yourself as God sees you, it will begin to heal the damaged self-images that a lifetime has formed in you. Because all of us have these self-images that all these things in our life and circumstances have put in us. When we believe the lies of the enemy, our self-image is warped. Like the fun mirrors in a carnival. You ever been to a carnival? You see all those mirrors and they make you like, and you go back and forth and then you make yourself wide and small. See, that's how the devil wants you to see yourself in those warped images. Not a clear picture of the righteousness of God. Living in the grace of God as a king and priest unto your God. He doesn't want you to see it. So he keeps these other mirrors in front of us when people remind us of things that we've done, of things that happened to us in the past. And we dredge these things up and they form these images. See, God, when we look into the washing and the and when we wash ourselves in the water of the word, those things are washed away. When Moses beat those bronze mirrors, he was showing us that that image can be beaten away. We do not have to live with the image that man has shown us who we are, or that we ourselves have decided who we are. We do not have to live with that image. We are a new creation in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. And we grow in grace. Amen. And now we're going to look at David. Now, David's really cool. Okay. He's a young boy who has a flock of sheep. And he is saving this flock of sheep. I mean, he killed a lion. Seriously, he killed a lion. And a bear. I think it was a bear. I wonder if there were two. This is a young boy who, I mean, defended his flock. He understood shepherding. Now, Samuel, the prophet, had come and anointed him to be king one day. And it's amazing that he stayed humble. Mm-hmm. I imagine he stayed humble because of his older brothers. He had a whole bunch of brothers. Mm-hmm. And I imagine they picked on him all the time. Just because of what we're going to read here, we see what they say about him. And so I imagine that he was really beat up by his own family. Hallelujah. David did not see himself as his brothers and Goliath saw him. He saw himself as the image of God. And we're going to see that in 1 Samuel 17, 17 through 30, through 51. We're going to read verse 28. Okay.
Yeah. He said, "Why did you come down here? And with whom have you left those few sheep in the wilderness? I know your pride and the insolence of your heart. You have come down to see the battle."
Now, you have to understand. His dad told him to take some cheese and some other stuff down to his brothers because they were in battle. Put them on a donkey and take them down there and give them some stuff. He gets down there and he sees this man yelling in the ravine. Huge man. Telling him that, come and fight me. If you can kill me, then it's all yours. You know? and he goes to his brother and he's like, what's going on here? Why are you not fighting this man? Do you not believe in the power and the strength of our God? And so his brothers, instead, he comes at him and says, why have you left your sheep down there? You insolent, prideful boy. You think you can do something about that? You ain't nothing. Look at your skinny self. And it didn't just come from him. It came from Saul. When Saul heard that David wanted to fight Goliath because he was going to stand up for God because he knew who he was in Christ. Mm-hmm. So even Saul came to him and said, and Saul said to David, you are not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for you are a youth and he a man of war from his youth. So even Saul, the king, says, you can't do this. You just some ruddy, young, small, tiny little boy. Just a teenager. Who do you think you are?
You've been fighting since he was before you were your age.
That's right. He's been busy beating people up. Goliath, 9.5 feet tall. And this young boy. And he comes back and he tells Saul, he says, no, I can fight this. And he has a boldness within him, but a humility along with that boldness. And the humility came because he knew who he was. See, when you find out who you are in Christ, you don't become more prideful. You become more humble because you know it's not by your works. It's by the works of God in you. So you become more humble and you rest more in God. And as you're resting in God, you're able to stand up and fight the fight that he put you in. Amen. That is the perfect way of putting it. He knew he had a covenant with God, and Goliath did not. So he goes before Goliath, and he calls out. He wants to read that. You can go to that part of that. It's not on here. It's in 1 Samuel 17. So a little bit further there. Yes, he did. First Samuel 17, and it's toward the end.
David said, "Moreover, the Lord that delivered me out of the paw of the lion and out of the paw of the bear, he will deliver me out of the hand of this Philistine." And Saul said unto David, "Go, and the Lord be with thee."
That's what he saw. He refused to see himself as who Saul said he was, the king mm-hmm. said he was. He refused to see himself as his brothers said he was. And so he's out there and he's getting ready to fight Goliath. And when the Philistine looked about and saw David, he disdained him, for he was but a youth and ruddy and a fair countenance. He's looking down on this little boy. Okay. But David knows who he is. And the Philistine said unto David, "Am I a dog that thou comest to me with staves?" And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. And the Philistine said to David, "Come to me, and I will give thy flesh unto the fowls of the air and to the beasts of the field." Then said David to the Philistine. Now this is the authority that he realized, like you said, Nathan. He knew his covenant with God. He said, "Then said David to the Philistine, thou comest to me with a sword and with a spear and with a shield, but I come to thee in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied. This day will the Lord deliver thee into mine hand, and I will smite thee and take thine head from thee. And I will give the carcasses of the host of the Philistines this day unto the fowls of the air and to the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. And all this assembly shall know that the Lord saveth, not with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands." Hallelujah! Talk about a confession of faith. He knew his covenant, and he went against the Philistine knowing, he went against Goliath, knowing he was going to defeat him. He picked up those five smooth stones, he took the stone, and he whacked him between the head, knocked him out, and cut his head off.
Using his sword. Using Goliath's sword.
That's good. Using the enemy's sword against him.
David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone, smote the Philistine, and slew him. But there was no sword in the hand of David. Therefore David ran and stood upon the Philistine and took his sword and drew it out of the sheath thereof and slew him and cut off his head therewith.
Wow.
And when the Philistines saw their champion was dead, they fled.
Amazing.
That's awesome. All he came with was the slingshot and a stone.
Hallelujah. That's right. That's all he had. See, it's so. See, David knew who he was, and Jacob found out who he was. It took him a long path, but he found out. But David, from being a shepherd, he understood authority, he understood the protection of a flock. And he understood, because of the covenant that you mentioned, that he had God on his side. That he was a warrior. That he could do all things through Christ who strengthens him.
Here's another thing where it's like speaking into existence, just a little bit before that. David said to Saul, "Thy servant kept his father's sheep, and there came a lion and a bear and took a lamb out of the flock. And I went out after him and smote him. Thy servant slew both the lion and the bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be as one of them, seeing he hath defied the armies of the living God." David said, "Moreover, the Lord that delivered me out of the paw of the lion and out of the paw of the bear, he will deliver me out of the hand of this Philistine." And Saul said to David, "Go, and the Lord be with thee."
Wow.
He knew.
He knew, and he confessed it. See, he said, "The Lord did these things for me." See, that's why his spirit was so humble. He knew it was the Lord who did it. So many people would have said, "I killed him." But no, David goes around and he says, "God did it. He might have used my hand, but he did it." Hallelujah. See, he knew who he was. So he had an inner strength within him to battle the battles that came before him and to keep his self-image when his brothers continually put him down.
And Saul gave David armor and such with a sword.
But it was too big for him.
He's like, I'm going to go with these because I've not proved them. And he took them off.
Yeah, so he went with a slinging stone. It is important for us to guard our ears and eye gates, as it is through what we hear and what we see that things are able to enter our hearts. So it's so important. When you hear people putting you down, don't take it personally. Just say to yourself, I am the image of God in Christ Jesus. God, through me, has conquered this last circumstance I went through. I am more than what this person says. I am more than that because I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. I am who he is in this world. I am a king and priest unto my God. I can walk in my authority. Hallelujah. The things we hear and we see and the things that happen to us constantly batter us. But see, it's not the circumstance that you go through. It's your reaction to that circumstance that's going to define who you are. Are you standing with God or standing with your flesh? Are you being who God called you to be, or are you allowing those things that are around us to make us into the image we think we are instead of the image that God created us to be? Amen? You are a child of the Most High God. You are equipped, empowered, and righteous. You are. Say that. I am a child of God, of the Most High God. I am equipped, empowered, and righteous. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Psalms 139. I'm going to end with this scripture because this really shows us how much God loves us, how much he cares, how great a God he is. That from the foundation of the world, he already knew you. He knew everything you would ever do, but he still called your name so that you would enter into the kingdom of God. The things that you did not defer his love from you. It's like the song said, that we're his beloved, and there's nothing that we could ever do that would change his love for us. Because he already knew we would do everything we ever did. And he sent his son to die for us, knowing what we would do, knowing how we would reject him, knowing the things that we would do to other people, and then knowing the type of image that we would end up seeing ourselves as. And he says, God says to his son, son, I love my people. And Jesus says, I love my people too. He says, I'm going to go down there. I'm going to die for them. And I know I'm going to rise from the grave. And I'm going to conquer death for them. And I'm going to conquer sin and conquer disease and conquer all these problems they have, and I'm going to live as a man, and I'm going to experience all these problems that they've experienced. But yet, I'm not going to sin, because I know that you're on my side, and I know that with you, I have a strength to be able to go on. So he didn't get offended at the things that happened to him. So he walked a life of man, but God. He says that he experienced all the things that we did, but he never sinned, so that we would know we had a God who we could lean on, who could comfort us with a comfort knowing what we're going through, and that he would hold on to us and love us and guide us and minister us right into the image that he has for us. So that we could be as he is in this world. Because see, we already are. That's just it. We already are as he is in this world. He just wants us to see that, so we walk in it. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Psalms 139. For the chief physician, a psalm of David. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You understand my thought afar off. You comprehend my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. For there is not a word on my tongue, but behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You have hedged me behind and before and laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain it. Where can I go from your spirit, or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend into heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall follow me, even the night shall be light about me. Indeed, the darkness shall not hide from you, but the night shines as the day. The darkness and the light are both alike to you. For you formed my inward parts. You covered me in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Your eyes saw my substance being yet unformed. And in your book, they all were written. The days fashioned for me, when as yet there were none of them. See, he's saying before they were even there, he wrote them. Every one of them. How precious also are your thoughts to me, O God. How great is the sum of them. If I should count them, they would be more in number than the sands. When I awake, I am still with you. Oh, that you would slay the wicked, O God. Depart from me, therefore, you bloodthirsty men, for they speak against you wickedly. Your enemies take your name in vain. Do I not hate them, O Lord, who hate you? And do I not loathe those who rise up against you? I hate them with a perfect hatred. I count them as my enemies. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxieties, and see if there is any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting. See, the Lord knows us. I mean, knows us so intimately. He knows every thought, every path we're yet to take, every decision we're yet to make. He knows. And today, this is cool. What is the greatest commandment? No, what does it say exactly? It says, oh, hear, oh, God. Our God is one. Oh, hear, oh, God, our God is one. You should love the Lord your God with all of your heart, your soul, and your mind. What did it first say? It said, oh, hear, your God is one. Exodus 20. When Jesus spoke the words in Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John, one of those, he repeated, and it said, oh, hear, our God, what does it say? Oh, hear, our God, that we are one. I just wanted to bring that out, that we all say that the first and greatest commandment, of course, is to love the Lord your God with all of your heart, your mind, your soul. You have to look in the New Testament for how it was written. But Jesus started off with hear God. Hear him. When we hear God, we're going to know his great love for us. Amen? Amen. When we hear him, we're going to know our God, because he speaks to us and he speaks to our heart, and he knows us from the inside out, and he knows every choice we are yet to make. Hallelujah. So yes, the greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God with all of your heart, your mind, and soul. But start off with hearing him. and knowing him. Amen. Mm-hmm. Amen. Pretty cool. I said, oh, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. Okay, it's here. Deuteronomy 6:4. Yeah, well, it's also the New Testament. It's in Mark. Yeah, Mark 12:29. Jesus replied, this is the most important. Hear, O Israel. Let me go to it right here. Mark 12:29. Yep. And Jesus answered him, the first of all the commandments is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. Is one Lord. Yes. The Lord our God is one Lord. That is so awesome. So he starts it off with, hear, O Israel. My people, hear me. The Lord our God is one Lord. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Hear him. And when we hear him and we read his word, we read his word and we hear him when we're reading his word. And we hear ministry, we hear him. And you will know as you are also known. Hallelujah. You will know as you are also known. You are a king and priest unto your God. You are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. You are as he is in this world. He is incredible and an awesome God, and he loves you with everything in him. Amen. Hallelujah. You want to pray? Close this up.
Come to you today, Lord, and we thank you for this word that you have given us. Thank you for writing it on our hearts and bringing it back to our remembrance all the time, Father, every time that we need it. You just remind us of who we are in you, Lord. We are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Just thank you for being with us as we go about our things, bless everything that we touch our hands to, Father, and we just give you all glory, honor, and praise in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen. Hallelujah.